Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. As you're listening to this, and we're still in November. No, we're not. We're still in December. Well, it's not a good start to this podcast. I can't remember where I am. But if you are listening to this as it comes out and you haven't paid that extra £1 for the Patreon, it is New Year. It's 2024. So let's look ahead at some future guests, future superstars in the world of Scottish wrestling. And I'm joined by a podcaster, a wrestler, a king of the class. It's Patryk Peterski. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me, Billy. It's, like I said to you before, it's genuinely an honor to be on here because I've been listening to you for a few years now. Just said to you before we started recording, you're like my introduction to Scottish wrestling, kind of outside of ICW during its peak, probably about 10 years ago. So, yeah, and here I am. This is quite cool. So, thank you for having me.
It's been quite nice this season. We had a GTT on from Community Pro Wrestling, and he kind of was saying the same. He listened to the podcast before he actually started training again. I'm like, oh my God, people are actually listening. That's really nice.
Yep.
For the number 10, we're currently, as of recording, we're now down to 10. We're now into the 10th best, well, 10th, the 10th best podcast in Slovakia.
Oh, no, don't worry, we'll bring that up. Myself and Duke will bring that up to the dizzy heights in a second again.
I know that was an amazing day when I went check
Yeah.
the old list. I was like, oh my God,
We've
why? Why is me
brought
listening?
it up once or twice since, so we're already planning our tour, our inevitable tour of like starting off in Bratislava, and we'll see how we go from there.
it's just mad because like, we get the chart list. I get the chart list every day, and sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not very good, but most of the time it's not very good. But the ones that do pop up is weird. It is like Slovakia or Ireland at one point. I was really excited that day. It was just yeah. Obviously, to top 250 in the British wrestling one, I'm happy with that. But yeah, Slovakia at number 10. I'm just anyone listening out there from Slovakia, get in touch. I want to know just why. So yes, we've got you on for a couple of reasons. Of course, you're on our network already for the Fair City Wrestling podcast, hosted with yourself and Duke Cannon. We'll definitely speak about that. Of course, you're wrestling yourself.
Yes, getting there, getting there. Still very much a trainee, but we move, we're progressing.
But I think you've got an interesting background of wrestling. Your journey before the actual wrestling began, as well. A lot of traveling, which again we'll try and get into while we're here. I'll inevitably forget something because that's how I roll with this podcast. But I'll make sure I ask the stupid questions. And the ones we got through on Facebook as well, before we wrap up. So we'll start with the basic, boring question. One you probably, I think you've already answered really with Duke on the FCW podcast, the impromptu one that you ended up on because of Dickie Divers not being able to arrive, which
Coward that is the FCW heavyweight champion Dickie Diver has bottled the podcast with us.
Dickie Divers not arriving. I can't believe it. It can't be for the first time. How did you get into wrestling? So what was the moment that you watched it and realized, this is what I love. This is wrestling. I'm in.
So my wrestling watching as a kid was very patchy because I didn't have anything outside. Remember when it was just channels 1 to 5 back in the good old days
I had
before,
one to
like,
four.
oh mate, oh. We used to we had a very cool thing in Dundee once upon a time. It was called Channel 6, and it was a local music station. So I was able to brag by people like, "Hey, we've got 6 channels in Dundee." So, but yeah, it was so I wasn't really on TV much when I was a kid, so my like exposure was very limited. Maybe when I went to a friend's house, it would have Sky. I might catch an episode of Raw or Sunday Night Heat or just even like the compilation shows. And God, this wrestling stuff's quite cool. And then outside of that, it was like video games. So like I remember like SmackDown 2 was like my go-to as a kid. And arguably that was more of like an exposure to guys like The Rock and Stone Cold, Triple H, etc., than actual WWF TV was, because I never had access to it. As I got a bit older, I went to, like, managed to get things like Sky. That would have been more sort of like Ruthless Aggression era, was really when I started watching wrestling religiously. Remember the first match I can properly remember watching from beginning to end was Eddie Guerrero versus Brock Lesnar at No Way Out. And I think, again, that probably just would have been on like a highlight package, like showing this match. And that's what really got me hooked on wrestling, because you see Brock Lesnar for the first time, and you're like, well, this is a foregone conclusion. There's no way this Eddie guy's beating him. And then he does, and you get this amazing reaction from the crowd. And that was when the like the religious week to week sort of watching started for me. Back then. So maybe I don't know, maybe what about 9 when that happened. So it was maybe a bit later than some other people get into it, but it's the usual. You get hooked once you get hooked, don't you?
Absolutely. I mean, that's what I was going to ask, because you're talking about the not having access to it, because right about my time, when I was about that age, it was Channel 4. But that would have just been, you would have been way too, probably too young at that point for the Channel 4 year.
I also might not have known it was on. That's like obviously like if you're a kid, then you don't always know. So yeah, that might have been a combination of that. Not knowing and not knowing it was on Channel 4 and not knowing it was accessible any other, because I know that WCW and stuff was like accessible around about that time as well on like British terrestrial TV. I never knew WCW was the thing until I was much older. It was always wrestling as for a lot of people for a long time. Wrestling is WWF, and that's kind of it. And then you eventually get a bit older and find out, oh, there's all this other stuff out there that I need to check out.
That's it. I mean, because we're operating on maybe a 6 year age gap and generation gap as well when it comes to wrestling, which it doesn't sound like a lot, but considering your first exposure was it maybe was seeing on Sky One or something like that and seeing a compilation, whereas 6 years ago looking for scraps on Channel 5 or Channel 4, and then people who had Sky were able to watch it on Men and Motors or wherever else. And then between that time there was the wrestling channel. And by the time that time you were talking about, it was kind of moving away to more the MMA stuff anyway, so it wasn't, there was less wrestling. It's just a lot could happen in that 6 years, whereas you're now in a jumping off point in 2004, seeing Brock Lesnar and Eddie Guerrero, and it's just mad to think how much can change in that time,
I know.
media wise.
It's not a long time in terms of like number of years, but obviously the leaps and technology and accessibility to wrestling around about that time was huge. So it's much more of a gap between, say, 1998 and 2004 than it was between, say, 2004 and 2010. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. I mean, the big difference between this versus that would be like advent of YouTube and all that kind of stuff, and then that's a whole other thing. But the general, like terrestrial telly and all that kind of stuff, it's much as such the same now. So yeah, it's just huge, and the cycle through characters as well. So when you started watching, you said Ruthless Aggression, Guerrero, Lesnar, and the games, you had The Rock, Austin. So again, that's a huge gulf. By the time you're actually watching it regularly, none of the guys in SmackDown Tube are there really. Maybe a Hardy, but Hardy maybe about. That was
No, the best
a
Hardy.
bit. I will fight you
Yeah,
on that. But somehow the one that takes all the illegal substances can still walk. I don't understand how that's possible out of the two. Anyway, so yeah, so must be weird watching that, not seeing all these guys SmackDown 2 who aren't on the show anymore. Were the two of the guys that you were drawn to the most?
2004 time. I was a big Cena fan, as a lot of young kids were for a while. The first guy I went through, like I remember I was on like message boards at this time as well, and I was getting first starting to get into that side of wrestling, finding out more about wrestling. And I was the guy that would like change his profile picture like every week. Like 1 week it would be like, oh, Shawn Michaels is my favorite wrestler. Next week it was like Cena. Next week it was Eddie, whoever. But the first time I got a guy who was like, yeah, this is my guy. I'm hitching my trailer at his wagon was CM Punk. So that was obviously a bit later than that in 2006. Very topical boy right now as we sit in November. In November, not November. I made the same mistake as you.
I
It's
made you do it.
December. It's
Yes.
because he's returned in November. That's what it is. We've got November on the brain. But yeah, CM Punk was the first my guy, and he's been that ever since for me. And coincidentally, I've now ended up with loads of tattoos right now. But the straight edge thing, I couldn't stick with that. Once I discovered the pleasure that
No, it's scary though. This will come out, what's first, second week of January. It could be gone by that point.
I know,
It's
who
it,
knows?
we're in such a scary, not scary world, but it's such an intriguing world where we're going week by week on CM Punk. It's like, is he still there? Has he punched anyone?
I was at All in August, so I when this comes out, I might still have seen his last wrestling match. Who knows?
Very
Who
true.
knows?
So it's a long time to the Royal Rumble. We've still got what as of release date, what 3 weeks to the Royal Rumble?
Yeah,
There's plenty of time for him to piss
that's
someone
fine.
off. Loads of time. The weird thing about straight edge thing, I think when I look back on that, it's like I think I was but didn't realize it. Mainly because for things like the promiscuity. nobody wanted me, so that really was an easy one to take off. But yeah, the drinking thing, I've never really done it for me. I don't know why. It's just I've always been a designated. I'm happier being a designated driver. I like knowing everyone's okay.
Oh, fair enough.
Otherwise, when I drink, I speak utter shit, which is conveniently what I do on the podcast. So imagine if I drink on a podcast. It's
Well, there's an idea. There's an idea.
I've done one or two when I've been drinking, and it usually ends up with me in a slight argument or telling someone to fuck off. So it has ended badly many times.
Myself and Duke of were trying to get the idea in Filthy Ryan Rude's head that we should go down to Newcastle and do a drunk podcast down there. Because we're just going to have a great night out after. And I think that'll be fantastic. So if you're listening, Ryan, the offer's still on the table.
That sounds like a Patreon exclusive. Just
Okay,
for the possibility of a letter coming through my door, trying to possibly try and extort money out of us. But yeah, so from that point onwards, you started watching. You got your favorites every week. I remember that profile picture thing when I first had my Bebo, my first profile picture, Bebo, my first profile picture
Oh yeah, I was a Bebo kid. Yep.
was Melina.
Oh yeah. Well, yeah, quite right. Best entrance in wrestling.
Absolutely. It was a picture that did me well in my youth. So you had your favorites then, and was it just the WWE you were all encompassed by, or were you able to
Mainly, it
branch
was
out a little bit?
mainly WWE. But one thing that was accessible for me on TV, because this is the stage that where I was starting to get access to things like Sky One. So I would get like the WWE experience with Todd Grisham. But we couldn't afford like Sky Sports. So I wasn't able to get like Raw and SmackDown like full cuts. But the wrestling show that I could get every week in full was Impact, TNA Impact. Again, this is probably during, and Smash and Asher will love that I brought up TNA because he's a big TNA boy. I know a lot about him that he might doesn't want other people to know, like his penchant for like doing wee dances and training, because he's basically FCW's answer to Daniel Garcia at this point. But he doesn't like people knowing. But one thing he does love sharing is his, and he's probably mentioned it on the episode that you've done with him, is he's a big TNA boy. And so was I back in the day, like probably like 2006, 2007, like Kurt Angle's just come in. AJ Styles is at his high flying best. You've got Samoa Joe, who's like not been defeated for like 2 years, going on a tear. It was good times. That was my like easy access was TNA, but I was still obviously trying to keep up with WWE at the time. That was that period.
It was great being able to go on to Challenge or whatever channel it was, and it was
It was Bravo, and then it was Challenge.
right, okay. I moved out on my own at that point, and I was just trying to catch what I could. I remember Challenge had it for a bit, and then Hogan came in and ruined everything.
Oh, I ruined it. Yeah, that was when I fell off TNA. I think as a lot of people did, because it was like, oh, okay, we are just going to late 90s WCW now. We're just repeating this. But the band were great. Eric Young joining the TNA version of the NWO.
Kevin Nash, X-Pac, and Scott Hall when he could come there.
Maximum pay, minimum effort.
That's the way you want it, isn't it? That's life. That's I mean, if you spend your life doing everything that you wanted to do, and you get paid just to stand in the background and go, "Hey, man, I've taken it.
Just go.
Pay me." So TNA. You mentioned that era, so yeah, Angle, Joe, Christian Cage,
Christian Cage, yep.
Daniels as well. It was such a it was when it was properly the alternative, when it felt different. It had the X Division, and it was using it to its full capacity, and it made sure that it was not counter programming. It was their own programming, and then yeah, Hogan came in and went, "No, we're going to counter program," and
Yeah.
broke it. It broke
But
all
that's
of it.
when alternative wrestling to WWE's when it's that's at its best when it is totally different. You don't want it to be the same, because if it was the same, you would just watch WWE because it's a better version of that. So why would you watch TNA if it's not different? It's like AEW. AEW is my favorite company right now because it gives you something different. Because I thought WWE was stale for a long time, and then AEW came around and I was like, oh my God, this is it reminded me of that kind of time in TNA. In the best possible way. It was like an updated version of that. And now TNA is back. And TNA have Okada now. So it is like 2007 again.
Yes, get that black mask on, boy.
I saw that. I think it was this morning or last night I saw that. And I was like, wow, TNA have got Okada in 2024. What is going on? What's going on?
No, the funniest thing was they actually put out the compilation of him being in TNA before. And I was like, I thought you'd want to keep that secret. Like, you don't want to put that back out, do you?
Because was that the thing that like ruined the relationship with New Japan as well? They were like, what have you done with this guy? This guy is like, we're going to build our company around him for the next 15 years, and you're just like ruining him, like ruining his credibility.
The Dutch Mantel's in the background going, you know what film I saw recently? The Green Hornet. So what we're going to do is absolute nuts. I don't know if it was Dutch Mantel, and he seems like a guy who would be pissy if I said that. So if it was, you Dutch, well, your moustache is a thing. Anyway, Sam Elliott's is better. So we're into that point then. TNA, going to part about WWE. Is there any thoughts at this point that you're thinking, okay, I need to find out what's happening around about me, or is it still just the worldwide wrestling that you're looking at? There's no thought of a local scene.
The thought never came across it local wise, because I was also obsessed with football. Well, I still am. I am still very much obsessed with football when I was a kid. So then it was all about just going to as many matches as I could, or playing as much as I could over the weekend. So wrestling was the kind of thing that I just, it was like the thing I just kind of did to relax, just as something different to just football. So there was never any, like, I never really had that urge to go and seek out indie wrestling. I don't really think I knew it was a thing either. But there also was never like a hunger to go and seek out and find it either. Mm-hmm. I remember going, the first show I went to was a WWE show, and it was Aberdeen. Might have been Aberdeen Evening News Arena maybe at the time, I can't remember. But I remember the main event was John Cena, Triple H and Shawn Michaels versus Rated RKO and Umaga. And
That was the second night.
Well,
I was at the first night.
There you go. What was the show that day? I remember I think Carlito wrestled either GTG or Shad. Can't remember which one. And I can remember, that's really only the two things I can remember from the show. I can remember them. I mean, the opener was Carlito wrestling one of Crime Time, and the main event was DX and Cena versus Rated RKO and Umaga.
That's a weird combo.
Yeah, I know, right?
So 2006 then, because I was at the other night of the Aberdeen one, whether it was the first or second. But it was, the main event was Rated RKO versus DX, and we got Cena Umaga earlier. I think it was first half main.
Right, yeah.
But no, it was Lance Cade and Trevor Murdoch against Crime Time is what I got as the opener. So that's such a weird mix to have Carlito versus one of them. Because I think he was in a four-way with Shelton Benjamin, Jeff Hardy, and John Morrison, maybe? Joy Nitro at the time?
Sounds right. Yeah, that's Raw Midcard 2006.
It was amazing. We got to see Flair.
Oh, great.
Highlanders.
Flair wasn't there Highlanders were there. I remember making a Highlanders sign, despite it not being on TV, but like, you know, you don't care when you're like 12, 15. You just want to have a sign at a wrestling show, because that's what you do. Remember signs? Signs aren't really much of a thing anymore. It's just everyone on their phones now.
I just hold them up. You can't read them because light hits them and all that kind of stuff. And the spirit
squad. Best sign ever was at All In. And I didn't see it on the day, but when I watched the show back, and I think I saw it the first time during Punk's entrance, because it was the first match. And it's when he would go on the apron and he would like do that pose, and camera just pans out, and it's just a guy with a sign saying "For Nan," and I'm like, a peep show reference. Yes. For Nan CM Punk, that's insane.
I think Matthew from Botchamania has built a whole sub genre of weird references on TV shows now.
I bumped into Matthew on the way out of that show, just walking down the stairs, and I sort of glanced to my right and I was like, Matthew, and he's like, "Oh, how you doing?" And to quote the Cultaholic Wrestling podcast, "How you doing, pal? How you doing?" And I was like, "Oh my god, it's Matthew Gregg. Oh my god!" Like, so I didn't want to be the guy. Can I get a picture of it? Can I get a picture? But I just wanted to be like, kind of like nice. I didn't want to draw attention. I'm like, look, I love you. You're obviously my second favorite wrestling podcast after yourself, Billy.
No, I'm like, your fourth favorite.
I did send you the Spotify raps. But I was like, oh my god, like, wow, like, you're great. We got downstairs though, and I said to Karen Douglas and Hunter Redwood from the DAPW school, who are trainees with me, so that's Matthew Gregg over there. Karen, same thing to me. Oh, Matthew, nice to meet you. How you doing? Hunter, who had had a few beverages by this point, roars out, "Oh my god!" His Matthew runs over and like gets him in a massive bear hug, like, picks him up and is like spinning him right. And Matthew's got no idea what he's going to like have to say to like get him to put him down. You ever seen The Longest Yard? Well, it's a great wrestling film.
He's Bob Sapp, is he?
When Chris Rock gets picked up and like spun around, best of time, that was what it was like. If he said like down Shrek down, or I wouldn't have believed him at all. But yeah, Hunter was a bit excited.
And he had a couple of drinks. Jesus Christ, is Hunter Redwood got a bit of you know, money on him at this point? Is he?
Yeah.
Hunter Redwood, he's made of money.
Yeah, exactly. He just kept getting the rounds in. We're like, yep, that's fine. I'll get the rounds in later when they're not in Wembley.
I'll get them in a Wetherspoons. Thank you very much. We'll just wait till then.
I wouldn't give that guy money. He hates sort of workers that want to work for a decent wage. But I'm not getting into that. I'm not getting into my hatred for Wetherspoons.
This is not a political podcast.
No, that's fine.
Except wrestling politics. We'll talk about that instead.
Oh yeah.
So from that point onwards, you weren't aware of like the independent scene or British wrestling in general. May have possibly somehow, if you did see the wrestling channel, may have seen FWA or something like that. Mm-hmm. But that was about it. So how did you find out about UK wrestling?
ICW was my first exposure. Probably about 10, 11, 12 years ago now. I would start seeing adverts for it. And I think obviously the BBC documentaries and that helped. That would have been, that's 10 years ago now. Where's that time gone?
God.
That's what 10 years feels like, Billy. That realization there. That's 10 years.
I had hair when the ICW Fight Club documentary came out.
And it was like Greedomania was starting to become a thing. He was all in. I'm just going to talk about all in. That was amazing. We could have gone home straight after that. It was great.
I didn't even watch all in. I just watched the pre-show hoping to see Grado when I saw him.
Oh, fair enough. Satisfied. I don't need to give him my money. Yeah.
You don't need my money. All in. That's fine. I've seen the bit I want to see. So. Yeah. Ace. Anyway.
First exposure to British wrestling was ICW. Started seeing that they were running shows in Dundee every now and again, back when they were essentially weren't too big almost to run Dundee. They did a few shows in Fat Sam, so I remember seeing like guys like Big Damo, who have now like he's had a hand in training me in a seminar, and that's pretty mental. I've saw guys like Dickie Divers, who has now chucked me out of a Rumble match and bottled a podcast with me, so that's quite strange. And I saw guys like Noam Dahl, who's now like one of the best things in NXT. So many, Joe Hendry, like so many. Jack Jester just won the title last night again, I think, at Fear and Loathing. I've not had a chance to watch it yet, but I will. And then you start to find out guys who've been on those shows, like, oh my god, like Finn Balor was in ICW, like, and then Drew McIntyre, who was like in his first run of WWE at the time, oh my god, he used to be in ICW. And you find out these bits and bobs, then makes you watch other things, then it's like, oh my god, wrestling is this massive thing, and I've only seen this little bit of it, albeit the biggest part of it in terms of like the biggest company. But then you just find out all these little things that you can go off and watch, and you're like, oh, this is so cool, it's even bigger and better than I thought it was wrestling.
So, because, well, I came into the scene at 2012, and it was Perth was my first show, and yeah, from there it was ICW, because you go online, type into YouTube Scottish wrestling, and it was that Insane in the Membrane show. Yep. was the one they had, and you got to see a lot of guys. One that struck me was Wolfgang, because he was just so big in comparison to everyone else, and look at him now, he's an NXT former tag team champion, and
Girls Boys on top. And drinks in man's pubs only.
Just man's pubs, that's
man's
it.
Man's pubs.
And all around just really nice guy, because he was at a rock and wrestle show, and my mate had dragged him along because he wanted to see what the fuss was about going to these shows. And Wolfgang was on NXT UK at the time, so he wanted to go see Wolfgang. And it's the only few times I've used my own kind of pool in wrestling, where we left and I saw that Wolfgang just came out to start taking down the ring. And I just went to the guy that was talking about going, can you let my mate in just to go meet Wolfgang? And Wolfgang was just very nice. It was just
that's good.
That's always the best way.
I'm glad, because Wolfgang's class. Love Wolfgang.
Very humble.
Yeah, him joining NAK was one of my favorite moments of watching ICW, when he was like throwing up his W and he just went like that. I was like, oh my god! Like, I loved Wolfgang. I loved the NAK as well. I just loved that they just like just battered everyone. And like there was I remember Iron Jew was a thing for a while with Colt Cabana and Grado. And I did think it was quite funny that they had that whole amazing moment at the Fringe where Iron Jew won the belts, but then it was like, oh wait, Colt Cabana's gonna have to go home. So naturally at the next show, which I think was like a week later, just like that sneaky, horrible NAK winning the belts back ruined everyone's fun.
It was such a busy time as well, and I think a lot of people like yourself, that's why a lot of people got into the Scottish wrestling scene. Yeah. A lot has changed since then, for better or for worse, for many reasons. And I think 2024 is really going to be an interesting year for ICW, especially. Their fight club's over. They're now going to, it just seems like, limited events, so I don't know if they're going to maybe get that buzz back that they had pre-pandemic, but it just makes it more exciting for me, I suppose, because I've got to try and find results for these. And if it's on fight every month, ace, I don't have to go chasing for results. I've just got to find someone who's watched it, because I never have the time for these things, it seems. So that's makes my life easier. So keep doing the ICW. You keep putting out shows on Fight TV live, and I don't have to chase for spoiler results. Ace. Okay, so you're in ICW. You've started finding out more about other promotions elsewhere. Which ones were ones you kind of traveled to, or was ones that you kind of picked up on first?
Well, again, traveling to shows wasn't the thing that I would do. I would try and find. I mean, I didn't really start going to shows in Scotland until a couple of years ago. And I would get to like the odd, say, Hydro show for WWE. But it was, I would find things online. Like I would look up, Ring of Honor was a thing that I would try and get and watch as much as I can. I would still dip in and out of TNA, basically just to check if Hogan was still there or not. obviously, when NXT became a thing, when it went down to Full Sail, that became like my favorite company. Again, talk about like the glory years of ICW, maybe a couple of years before that. You've probably on from that, you had like the glory years of NXT, where it's like Finn Balor's first run. You had Sami Zayn's rise to the championship, and then Kevin Owens just dominating for a few months. You had amazing tag teams like Enzo and Cass, which I still can't believe they never won the championships in NXT. Then you had the Revival at the time. American Alpha, loved American Alpha. I thought they were fantastic. Such a shame that Jason Jordan's career had to get cut short when it did. Again, it's just one of those like Asuka, Bayley, Four Horsewomen. It was an amazing time. But NXT was my company for a long time. I'd watch that every week, and then just kind of skim through on SmackDown for the bits I like. But NXT was like amazing viewing, and again, you had, like I said, you had Ring of Honor. That's when I started to get introduced to people like the Young Bucks. It was most like a tapas of wrestling. I would just kind of take bits from every promotion that I liked and just make sure I watched that. And if it was stuff I wasn't interested in, I would just kind of skim over it. Because, you know, it's, why would you want to watch stuff that you weren't really that into if you could just kind of pick and choose what you like or what you think at least you're going to like? If I see a match that grabs my attention on a show, I'll try and make sure I watch it. And if the rest of the show is a bit meh, I'll just probably skim through it and then, or even just not bother with it at all.
Unless you paid $50 for it,
exactly. Yeah.
You're just happy that you got to watch the wrestling.
Yeah.
That's the way it should be. It should with all these internet nerds going on about I watched Raw, it was awful. Well, you said that last week. Why are you still watching it this week? Just like, you know, you're making it harder for yourself.
Exactly. Don't do it to yourself. Exactly. Watch the stuff that you'll like, and just don't put crap memes on the internet about demographic stats and like TV viewerships, because I mean, who watches wrestling live now, really? Especially in this country, because like you don't need to. So does it really matter what rating like Raw or SmackDown or Dynamite did in this demo and all that? Because like people might not watch it for like 3 or 4 days when they have time, because life is quite busy. Other things get in the way, posting photos of hard cam sections. It's like is that pattern now? Is this what we're doing?
It's like the CM Punk thing we mentioned there. So I don't know what I never paid any attention to ratings or buy rates or any of that kind of nonsense, but I don't need to. It's not part of what I need to worry about when I'm watching wrestling. But CM Punk coming back had, what, 71 million social media impressions? I think that's probably a bit more important than the 2.5 rating on USA or whatever. Like the exposure to the company. I don't want to use the word exposure too much because it's got a negative connotation in Scottish wrestling, but the exposure is more important in that respect than a rating, I suppose.
Absolutely.
So we'll get back onto your wrestling journey.
Okay.
So we mentioned what you've watched, what you've enjoyed, what you kept watching. So how did Kaithness come into the equation here? So I don't know if it was when it was still Kaithness Championship Kaithness Pro Wrestling or Combat League. When did that kind of become a
factor? It was Combat League for me. Mention it on the FCW podcast if you've listened to that. So I'll try and not go into it too much because if you want the full fat thing, you can go listen to that episode.
There we go.
There you go. Cheap plug. But basically, my best friend, a man by the name of Albion De Quincey, got into training up there in Thurso. It was Combat League when he got into it. So they'd moved into that Combat League wrestling then. He moved up there about 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago now. So we met at university in Dundee and he got a job up in Thurso. And like me, big wrestling fan, one of the things we bond over, football and wrestling, we're like two peas in a pod. We're like separated at birth. It's crazy. Albion's a good guy. You should get him on one day. I've tried to get him to contact you before, but he has kind of taken a bit of a sabbatical from wrestling now. He's got his reasons for it, but hopefully, you never say never. If, like I said, if CM Punk can come back and Okada can go to TNA again, then there's no reason why Albion might pop his head up above the parapet.
That's the third.
That's the Holy Trinity, right? The Holy Trinity is CM Punk, Okada, and Albion De Quincey. But yeah, Albion got into training up there. And they got on what is a very exclusive roster because they've had a bit of trouble the last couple of years with like injuries and illness and stuff, and they've had to get substitutes. But the whole concept of Combat League, there's only 12 wrestlers every year. It's four houses of three wrestlers. They have a championship, but the championship's not as important as essentially every match is equally as important because you're fighting for the house points. And at the end of the season, the house for the most points wins. It's a very unique concept to wrestling. I quite like it. So I started going up to shows to watch Albion because he's my best friend. I'm going to support him. And I thought, I'm probably going to go up. I'll watch some wrestling, but I'll only really be bothered about Albion's match. But I just absolutely fell in love with Combat League because there was an amazing talent up there. Local guys like Albion, you've got guys like RJ Cash, you've got guys like Lad Chapman and Connor Rose, who I believe you've had on the podcast in the past.
I have, yeah.
Yeah, because you definitely have, because I've listened to their episodes. They're two really good guys. RJ Cash, I think, is a fantastic wrestler. He's another local guy up there as well. And then you've got more sort of imported people they've had up in the past. You've got like Logan Smith, who was on, obviously, ICW's Fear and Loathing show last night. He's part of the tag team champions. Lucha Diaz goes up there. And then Brody Adler, who, of course, we've got in FCW and was up there for Combat League. And that was my first introduction to her. And who else has been out there that I now know? Darren J. Blair as well.
The season you were on, the season, well, the first one anyway.
That was 2022. Oh, Taylor Veit. Oh, I really, really wanted to like Taylor Veit, but he just, because I thought he was very captivating as a guy, and he just kept stabbing my best friend in the back. And now I can't wait until I get in the ring with him and tell him what I think of him, because he's a prick.
Get your IT quote, IT crowd quotes ready.
I've got a lot of ammunition I'm going to unload in some promotional content one day if I ever get a chance to get in the ring with him.
You're going to toss him away like yesterday's jam and all that.
Yes, yes, yes. You're a man of culture like myself with IT crowd references. My wife doesn't like the IT crowd, but I just tell her that she's wrong. There's no debate.
My wife's never watched it. She doesn't particularly like stuff with laugh tracks. I think the only exception to that rule seems to be How About Your Mother and Friends. That's it. It seems to be the only exceptions to the rule.
You know what? I've never known that it had a laughter track until you mentioned that to me. But that's a sign of a good TV show, because that means you're probably laughing along with it and not bothered.
But I remember when I came down to Ardler Mania and ADM was on the show, and I was speaking to him very briefly beforehand, and it was just, I think one of the first things he said to me, it was just walked past going, Mysterious. I was going for Ruddy Mysterious, and then walked away. I was like, oh, I love you, ADM. you're terrifying during the show, but other than that, it's just more IT Crowd references. We briefly floated the idea, and it never came to anything. Was doing an IT Crowd podcast with Taylor Vite, Grant McIver, and ADM. And it was called A Dream in £6 million.
But also, the manifesto are all in the IT Crowd. there's like a gimmick change that we now need.
That's it. Just have an ADM come out in the next show. Last Fight Club, why not? And just go, Father!
I think Taylor would definitely be the Richard Iwadi.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Grant could be Jen. Stick a wig on him. All good. All work.
Still doing the IT.
Could be Richmond. Anyway, right, no, we're moving off topic now. Let's get back to this wrestling. So, Combat League gets the Albion. That's a fair trek just to go see some wrestling. So it must have been.
Well, I would go and see him anyway.
Shows.
I would go and see him anyway, but this now became an excuse to go more often because they were doing a show every 2 months. So I would normally go up like two or three times a year, and he would come down to Dundee two or three times a year. Whereas this was now an excuse to go and see him like six times a year in Thurso, and then he could still come down and see me. So it was an excuse for us to see each other more and wrestling. So, you know, what a combination.
So we're seeing that local scene for Combat League and what have you. Did that kind of maybe jog something into your mind thinking, okay, right, yeah, I want to try and do this now as well?
Absolutely, because then I remember when I was talking to him about like, oh, how's training been? How's it been doing this? And he said, oh, mate, it's amazing. Like, you need to try and find something around about your area. And I remember we were watching, just scrolling through YouTube one night before one of his shows, and we found FCW Empire on YouTube. And I can't remember who he was wrestling at the time. The first match we clicked on was in Ian Ambrose match, because I'd heard the name Ian Ambrose before. I'd probably seen him on posters around Dundee before, but I know that name. And he was wrestling in a wedding dress. And I was like, oh, this is that Ian Ambrose guy that I've heard about before. This is a bit strange. I can't remember who he was wrestling, but he was wrestling in a wedding dress. But now that I know Ian, I'm like, yes, this is very Ian Ambrose. I would not have been surprised if I'd known who he was to have seen him coming out in a skull mask and a wedding dress. The first match that really piqued my interest in FCW, though, it was a Fatal 4-Way match. It was a number one contendership, actually. It was Spike Tierney, Sebastian Asher, Duke Cannon, who, of course, I now do a podcast with. This is very cool. And at the time, Titanium Tom Atlas, before he went all sort of green and emo and more scouse than he was before, as part of the Neo Power thing. And they had a banger of a Fatal 4-Way match. And I thought, I need to get involved. And I saw the advert for the training school as well. And I was like, right, I now know that this is like in Tayside. This is on my doorstep. If Albion can do it, then why can I not have a shot at this myself? And we'll see if I can do it. So yeah, that was like, I remember seeing Ian. I remember seeing the four lads in the Fatal 4-Way. And I thought, right, I've got to give this a go.
So I don't know if that's good or bad for Albion. But if he can do it, I could probably do it. It'd be fine. Don't worry about. But did you always kind of have a? So when you saw that, did you have a gimmick in your head straight away? Were you like, right, okay, I'll do the training. We'll get through it. That's fine. But I've already got the ideas of what my character is going to be. Or did you take it a more logical approach of I want to try and train first, then character later?
Yeah, I didn't want to get ahead of myself. I didn't want to be the guy that shows up to wrestling training on the first day and be like, right, lads. So like, I've booked myself on shows for the next 2 years, and this is how my character arc is going to go, and it's going to end with me winning the SCW Heavyweight Championship. I was like, right, let's just see if I can remember how to do a forward roll. Turns out I didn't. It took me a while to master it. Let's see if I can do basic training without totally killing myself. As you can imagine, at the start, it was like horrible. I weighed a lot more than I do now. That's another good thing about wrestling training as well. It helps you drop a hell of a lot of weight. Something that Tom Atlas has helped me with, again, until he turned green and sort of a simp for you and G Mackey. That kind of went by the wayside, but you know, he did help me get started, so thank you, Tom, begrudgingly. I had my first ever match with Tom. It was on a gala show last summer, and I battered him, and out of nowhere he just hit me with that knee and like basically sparked me out. So I've got a bit of bitterness towards Tom. I need to run this back in the future. Once he's figured out what he wants to do with Ewan. Because I don't know if you saw on Friday, but they had their sort of strained relationships been showing a few more cracks. So
I've been hearing it's getting a bit weird. But every time you mentioned Tom, though, the only thing I've got in my mind is, did you hear him scream at Adlermania when he got thrown through the back by Zach Dynamite? Oh, yeah. It was beautiful. It still goes in my head. It's just, it was like a racing car going past the F1. It was just, beautiful. Anyway.
Sorry, I've lost my train of thought there. Yeah, so I didn't have an idea about what I want to be. Like, I mean, Patrick is me and I am Patrick, you know? Like, they say that about wrestling as well. Sometimes it's better just to sort of turn yourself up a wee bit more. I've been dubbed essentially wrestling Liam Gallagher. Yeah, that's pretty accurate. Big Oasis fan. I wear a lot of paisley and bucket hats and stuff like that. I just try to be me, Billy, because that's who I am.
Easiest way, isn't it? Especially if you start out, it's probably more mind to try and make sure you're doing matches safely and in some sort of smooth entertainment, and then the character bit can maybe come afterwards once you've got the first two bits sorted as well. I imagine someone who's never done it, I've just watched it for long enough to think I know a little bit more. So did you never did e-fedding? No, that wasn't in your past on Bebo.
E-fedding. What would that be like? Fantasy booking or something? What's that?
Oh God, now I feel old.
This is good. Right. I'm learning things. I like
e-fed. E-fedding was when you were a character, and it was like role play kind of thing, and you send in your promo, and then the winning promo wins the match. And it sometimes went really well, but if you see the other person's promo and you go, "Well, my promo was better," then it starts causing rifts in real life, and it was quite the scene. I don't know, way longer than it should have been at my age. But no, every week I put in my promo and I would either win or lose, win titles or lose them. I would always be pissed off, of course, if you lose the title, because you know that's just
losing's not fun.
Yeah, exactly.
It's much better.
Especially when you lose it to people that have used wrestler names, you know, like Homicide Hernandez. You go, no, I took the time. I've picked a terrible name, it's the Bean. And I didn't find out until later it was a terrible name. But still, I took the effort and I made a character here, you pricks. And you just went for... Anyway, I'm still bitter about it.
This is when you find out that Homicide was actually in that chat. And it was just, he was cutting promos on you.
One day we're going to do this and the guest's going to go, "Oh yeah, I did used to e-fed. I think my name was Hernandez." So, like, you, it's you. So yeah, that was introduction to wrestling for e-fedding. I'm sure it still goes on now, because you see the people online do like 2K23 e-feds kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's the same kind of thing, I'm sure. But yeah, it was an interesting time. I'm absolutely positive there'll be someone. Duke seems like an e-fedder.
Yeah.
If he hadn't e-fedded, I would be shocked.
If he doesn't, you'll definitely know what it is. You'll probably got a stockpile of like wrestling fan fiction somewhere as well. I remember somebody showing me, I think it was like Tumblr Shield fan fiction, and it was just about them all having sort of adult cuddles with each other. And I'm like, even by Tumblr standards, this is strange.
Oh no, I don't. As long as it's not hurting anyone, I suppose. Nah. I mean, as long as I don't have to read it, I suppose, as well, so it doesn't hurt me. Right. So, Dundee Academy of Pro Wrestling.
Yes.
I've heard it being called DAPW. You've called it DAPW.
DAPW.
I'll be honest, I'm in the camp of I don't like that. But, you know, I'm not going. So it's not my problem.
Why not? We've got a show on January 27th, Billy. It's only a fiver.
Oh, no, I meant just the name DAPW.
All right. No, general. I just meant not going to the shows, you know. Oh, no. Definitely go to the shows.
I need to get to more shows. It's a hard life having a child and having a mortgage. I'm trying to go to what I can, but I'm glad I got to at least one FCW show. Last year, I suppose.
Yeah.
In a very hallowed ground for my wrestling time, which... We may find out in the future if we ever jump on an FCW podcast, whatever my history of wrestling in Dundee.
The invite is there, Billy. The invite is there.
As brief and unexciting as it is until I start drinking, and it gets a bit more exciting, but probably a bit more libelous. So from that point then, you've started training, and you got your bucket hat, you got the Paisley, your what have you. How long was it before you were starting to get on the show, or at least get your first match, that King of the Class Battle Royal?
So I started training in October 2022. Just after I got married, because the deal with the wife was, can you just wait until we get married first? Because you'll end up starting training and you'll like have a serious injury and you'll break your nose or something. And she didn't want that in the wedding photos. And I was like, you know what? That's fair. Let's start the marriage off on the right foot. Because the worst kind of heat in the world is wife heat. And you don't want that. So, yeah, started in October. And my first match was... it was a DAPW trainee battle royal on Nay Mercy, which was a show we did again at Ardler. It was last, I think it was April 1st, 2023. I got in Holden's face and he smacked me in the face. And I was like, oh, wow. Yeah, I am now in the club now. I'm officially in a wrestling match because this big, big behemoth of a man in Holden smacked me in the face. And I gave as good as I got. Kieran Douglas ended up chuck me out. So thanks, Kieran. We've come quite close since then, but he doesn't let me forget that he eliminated me from our first match. But you know, it's whatever. I'm not better.
Not at all.
No. After a few more months is when we got into like the gala season. I had a couple of matches on there. Like I said, I wrestled Tom Atlas and Errol on a show. Again, I was doing really well until I turned around and he kneed me in the face. And I woke up about 20 seconds later, and I'm like, oh, what happened? Because say a lot about Tom, but he does have a pretty solid knee. Remember we did a show on Methven maybe about a month later, and I teamed up with Jay Robin for the first time. We've had a couple of training matches since then. We have a monthly thing in DAPW where we're having matches with each other to get guys more experience. I've tagged with Jay a few times. The Polish Hammers, we've dubbed ourselves. Great tag team name. Because like me, he's got a Polish background. I wrestled G&G Mackey and Grum in that match. That didn't end well for me. Solomon Grum picked me up like I was nothing and planted me with a big choke slam. Or got goozled, as they say. Because, you know, SmackDown, Taz. I was the best. So that was my experience of like, we had a Rumble that day as well to try and qualify for the main event. And again, I was doing really well in that until Brody Adler decided to just manhandle me and chuck me out of the ring. But the success I did have was on the DAPW show that we had, where I won this amazing crown. Look at this. Just conveniently have it here. There you go. Look at that. That's worth a lot of money. but yeah, we had a King of the Class battle royal with all the trainees. And I ended up eliminating. It was John Kerrigan I chucked out last at Queen's. And that was my first taste of success in wrestling. And I'm defending that crown on January 27th. You'll have not heard this yet because, you know, timelines. But I've put out in my royal proclamation, I've done an alternative Christmas speech, Billy.
Oh, wonderful.
Because, you know, because King Paddy is better than King Charles. Although, not to get political as well.
Oh, no, no.
But I don't remember King Charles winning a battle royal to win his crown. And you know, I did.
I bet Harry would have had a good go. He would have run out at the end, hide under the ring, throw him out at the end.
The Windsor Battle Royal. That should have been the thing, right? we're turning up a notch for the next show. It's not going to be a King of the Class Battle Royal. It's going to be a Rumble match. And I wanted this. I wanted to turn it up. Let's use my reign for some good. Let's make things bigger and better. So I said to Commissioner Williams, he says, no, we're not doing a Battle Royal again. I want to win a Rumble. And so that's what we're doing in January. I'm also going to be in the tournament to crown the first DAPW champion in January. So that's what I've got to look forward to in the future. And the last match I had, actually, I just remembered, I did make my proper FCW debut in the Fair City Rumble, which was, again, just amazing to, like, it was almost a year to the day that I'd started training. So to have gone from there to have been on, like, a pre-show match at Nay Mercy to wrestle in Ardler, like, obviously, I hadn't really known about the history of wrestling in Dundee and like how that was like the Madison Square Garden, if you want to call it that. That was the big venue. So to wrestle for FCW there on a pre-show, that was very cool, and a debut match. To get some experience wrestling in front of a crowd on FCW galas and to wrestle on the DAPW show, again, amazing. But then to get like the chance to wrestle on a full-blooded FCW show in the Empire Zone, as we've now dubbed it, the Tulloch Institution, that was, couldn't have had a better rookie year, if you want to call it that. So it's been a blast, Billy. And so hopefully 2024 will continue that, and we'll get bigger and better as we go.
Well, you blasted through my notes here for our matches.
Sorry about that. It's been your job for you.
Exactly. I was like, right, okay, well, once he stopped, we'll talk about the first City Rumble, and you've done it. Okay, cool. So when you made your debut, though, did you feel like you were prepared enough for it? Was there any nerves, or you thought maybe I could have done another month of training, a couple more forward rolls, and I'll be ready?
Nitro Green showed me how to do forward rolls, so shout out to Nitro Green. Turns out I find it a lot easier rolling on my fists rather than just on my hands, so like thank you, gorilla. Nitro Green. Yeah, exactly, yeah. Big Polish gorilla. I felt definitely ready for a rumble. I was like itching to get in, but that doesn't stop you like bricking it before, but nerves is, I remember Albion said this to me before. He had his first match. He was tagging with Taylor up in Thurso. He was wrestling Connor Rose and he was wrestling Glenn Dunbar, who I had the pleasure of meeting that day. He turned up at the Rumble. I was, oh my God, like, hi. Like, and it was funny because it was like, oh, I've been like watching you in Combat League for the past couple of years. He's like, oh yeah, I know. Like, I know you. You're Albion's mate. Because obviously Albion's told him about me. It's like, oh, Clint Dunbar knows who I am. That's quite cool. But yeah, and one thing Albion told me before their match was, Glenn had said to him, like, are you nervous? And Albion goes, oh yeah. I'm like, bricking it. And Glenn's like, no, good. That's a good thing. Because like, it means you care. So I totally get that way of thinking. It means you care. You want to go out and do a good job. You want to go and put on a good show for the fans. And obviously, not make a tit of yourself, and hopefully that you do a good job in the ring. So yeah, I was bricking it, but I was quite happy with what I did. I gave a big bloody Polish hammer to Caleb Valhalla and sat him down, and I was like, oh, what have I got in these hands? I can like slay the mighty Viking for a brief moment. But yeah, it was a blast, even though I was in there for a cup of coffee, and I was Dicky Divers cowardly slid in and tripped me out.
I love that everyone has the same story about Glenn Dunbar for the first time. It's always that. It's him coming up going, are you nervous? Yeah, good. Yeah. And that's it. Yeah. It seems to be the same story everyone has.
Yeah. I've not had the pleasure of wrestling him yet, but I know that that's his thing now, obviously, for Albion. And I thought, oh, yeah, it's a good... I think he quite likes wrestling people in their first match. From what I think that's the kind of the things I've heard about him. And he's kind of like showing you the ropes, basically. Because I know he was a coach down at Source, wasn't he? Like, Source was his thing. Are they part of Girders now, I think? I can't actually remember.
No, it's GPWA.
GPWA, yeah.
Yeah.
So no doubt he'll be doing his thing down there as well now. So, yeah, I heard nothing but good things about Glenn. So it was nice to meet him in person as well.
So as we've blasted through your wrestling career so far, and got your show coming up at the end of the month when this gets released, we'll jump into some questions then. Actually, before we do that, I want to talk about your podcast career.
Yes.
So people may not be aware that Fair State Wrestling Podcast isn't your only, or wasn't your only podcast endeavor. The way we were introduced initially was maybe you sent me results for Combat League.
Yeah.
But you'd also done reviews or chatted about Combat League Wrestling.
Recorded on like a potato in my kitchen.
On the perfectly balanced podcast, which if you're saying it's done but on a potato is wonderfully ironic as the name. Yeah. But yeah, the Perfectly Balanced Podcast. So what made you decide to try some podcasting?
So the Perfect Balance started with my friend Mark. It was just after the pandemic, like things had started to, well, not after the pandemic, because that's quite patchy. When is the end? It's like defining the Attitude Era. When did it begin and end? But like when things were starting to open up again, you're allowed to go to live events. I thought, right. Let's kind of document this time, because we'd gone for like a whole year of, or year and a half, or however long it was, of not being able to do anything. And at the time in my life then, football was still like the kind of live activity thing that I would go and watch. So I wanted to go and kind of document that time of going back to football again with like my dad and my friends, because I thought it would be something cool to look back on in a few years' time. And that was kind of the vlog side of things. But we'd also wanted to try the podcast because me and Mark just spoke absolute rubbish about football all the time. So why not just do it for a podcast and see if anyone bothers listening? They didn't really, but we still had fun. The first episode we ever did, it was when Scotland had just qualified for Euro 2020. And it was like announcing, if we were the manager, this is what squad we would pick. Because if you're into football, you care, and you will actually listen to two complete dafties just saying, I would pick this player. No, I would pick this player. This is why. And I always wanted to do it. I'd always been a fan of podcasts. First podcast I properly got into was True Geordie's podcast. I really liked the long form contentness of it as well. I didn't just really like sort of like quick fire 10, 20 minute interviews. I like kind of sitting down and listening and getting into somebody's head for an hour and a half or whatever it is and finding out how they tick, what they've done, where the story is, etc. Similarly, obviously, to what you do, going on a journey with people. And then you really find out more about them rather than just like a quick 5-10 minute interview. And yeah, so we just thought, yeah, why not have a go? And I thought, well, I'm going up to see Albion. Why not get him on as well? And yeah, just kind of, I was just winging it, absolutely winging it. Just doing what I felt like.
Same here. This is episode, this goes out over 242. And you saw me struggle to try and find the record button on Zoom. this is the level that we've got going on here. I still don't know what I'm doing. The only good thing is I've got like my PC was my actual work PC. That's about all that I've got professionalism. This is a Christmas present. Yeah. I've put very little into my own podcast here. So I'm glad that yourself and people have actually listened to it. And when it comes to like doing the long form stuff, I think it's mainly I've ended up doing long form stuff because I'm incredibly awkward and I don't know how to finish up podcasts. So I just keep them going until I realize, oh no, we've run out of things to speak about. Let's wrap up now. And we'll hit that probably soon because we're about an hour in now. So now is the time where I think, right, is it too long? And they get
no,
bored?
No, it's not. Let's keep going. Let's go longer than you and G Mackey's FCW podcast. He did like 2 hours and 15 minutes, but like, come on, we're not even halfway yet.
Oh, I did the Christmas party episode that came out. It was 2 hours 20. I was like, oh my
God,
how have we talked about this for 2 hours? So we'll talk about FCW podcast then, because the initial debut, the inaugural pilot episode, you weren't involved with. It was Duke and Nathan North. I can't remember if Duke had talked to me, but I definitely spoke to Duke about it. I wanted more focused content on the network. I thought you could be a good fit anyway for hosting a podcast. Yeah. And then he ran with it, and here we are. So how did you end up getting involved with that?
So Duke approached me one night at training, and I think like you, he'd heard that I'd done the Perfect Balance before. That was why I'd done a podcast. I'd had some podcasting experience. Perfect Balance has kind of died now, sadly, because Mark's moved away and he's had a family. So, you know.
How dare he?
I know, right? Selfish. But yeah, so just, but I think it came to like a natural end anyway, because it was more of like, we're kind of back now going and doing things. It's not like I'd had it in head. I wanted to do it for a while, just see how it went. And I'd done like a season and a half of like the football content. And I thought, right, okay, Mark's moved away. This is just kind of a natural end to it anyway. So, but Duke had known that I'd had that experience. So I kind of knew what I was doing. Like he knew at least I could say talk on camera for a while. And have it or on a microphone, because it's just an audio podcast we do. But he knew I'd be fine with it, and he spent enough time with me to know that I just like blather an absolute rubbish for as long as a podcast lasts. So I was very happy that he came and asked me to do it. Kind of glad that he did now, and it wasn't himself and Nathan North that were doing it, because they're having their issues, to say the least.
Of course.
Duke. As we're recording this, we're only a few days out from Duke turning on Nathan. I don't want to speak for Duke. I've not had a chance to speak to him myself yet. But I think he has his reasons. But again, I don't want to say for him. I did kind of think he was being a bit strange during the last episode with Jay Robin, the way he was kind of speaking about the match. If you listen to the podcast, especially now with hindsight, you'll probably know what I mean. But I didn't want to, like, obviously, sort of poke at it, because he's been a bit raw ever since he lost the titles anyway. But I think in the back of my head, I think Duke has his reasons for what he's done. I don't agree with him personally. I think they could have probably dealt with it in a much more mature way. But we'll just need to wait and see.
It was funny when it happened, when I got the results through, find them. I think one of the usual content folk on Twitter put them up. And my selfish first thought was, oh shit, is the podcast still going to happen then? Am I still getting content? And I thought, maybe not ask.
No, well, I'll find out very soon for you, because I think it's Monday now. I think this Sunday we're recording a special Christmas episode, which will obviously be out now as when this comes out. So we're having the commissioner on, Kevin Williams, for that. So that'll be probably the first time I'll get to properly speak to Duke. And it's probably a conversation I'll have face-to-face anyway. Look, are you okay, etc.? Like, what's happening?
Mm-hmm.
But don't worry about the FCW podcast. The FCW podcast will go on. So there's no threats there. I've not done anything to Duke, so there's no reason why he would stop doing the FCW podcast.
I mean, to be fair, he didn't do anything to smash an Asher, and yet he still Duke still got knocked out in the, what was it, first proper episode.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, that's Sebastian, though. He's
dancing.
Oh God, yeah.
Right, let's finally get into these questions then, because there's loads. So yes. We'll start with Instagram, just so I can make sure I don't have to look at my phone again. IB Scotty has asked, dream triple threat match, one person from WWE, AEW, and TNA.
Oh. Right. WWE, it's got to be, well, he's back there now, so I can say CM Punk. AEW will throw Kenny Omega in there, because we never got to see it in AEW. That was bizarre, wasn't it? That we never got a CM Punk versus Kenny Omega. I know before Brawl Out and all that, obviously, but even before then, I thought it was crazy that wasn't one of the first things that they did. TNA. Do we mean like current TNA, or do we mean all time TNA, Scotty's?
I don't know, Scotty's just, he said, that's the question he set. So right. You can maybe play about with the vagueness of the rule.
Right, we'll have Kazuchika Okada, because he's booked for a TNA show, so let's have him. That's a match I'd like to see.
But Osprey, no, they can throw Osprey.
I mean,
technically.
Technically, we'll stick with Okada. We'll go with Okada.
I was trying to think of that one myself.
Because I mean, Kenny and Okada have had a couple of decent matches, so throw Punk in there. We'll go with that. That'll be a banger.
So I hear. I've never watched any of them myself. I get intimidated by like a match that's an hour. I'm like, oh, seems like ages. Just
they are very, very good. Ignore the whole like everyone sort of hangs on Dave Meltzer's every word. But they are generally very good matches.
One day I'll eventually. That's just remind me, I'm supposed to watch something between now and an episode going out, and I forgot what it was. Oh well, that's another problem for another time. Yeah.
When are we getting the Billy rating? Because you are essentially Scotland's answer to Dave Meltzer, so
I don't rate things because I have a very it doesn't stop Dave, but I have a very particular thing I like in matches, and it's silly bollocks. And
that's what people don't get. It's like, this is Dave Meltzer's idea of what a 7-star match, whatever it is. He's one guy. You're allowed to disagree with him. Like,
exactly. I'll just be sitting here with, I don't know if you've seen any Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed's promos. I'd be sitting here just giving Mr. WrestleZone 5-star matches because I've enjoyed every single moment and I cannot pick a problem with it. And that'll be it.
If you enjoy silly bollocks, stay tuned to what I've got planned for 2024. That's all I'm saying.
Flip an eye out of context.
There we go.
So yeah, I was trying to think what I would probably have in that situation. I don't watch a lot of AEW, so I'm kind of a little bit in the dark for who's good and who's not good. So I'd probably just throw in, I don't know. I like talking, so I'm giving me Kevin Owens, MJF, yep. And from TNA, Joe Hendry.
Oh yes.
There you go.
That'll be a good match.
Exactly, you get some great stuff on the outskirts with all the promos as well. So
yeah,
that would be my triple threat. Very much different. Yours is more of a work rate triple threat. Mine is, they'll probably throw himself off something really high at some point, and I'm going to enjoy it.
I'm just picturing like a Joe Hendry entrance for somebody like MJF or Kevin Owens. That's now something I want to see.
Oh, beautiful. Something Canadian-y and that. It's going to be...
If for Owens, I'd want him to go like full South Park and have like the head going
absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Must be. That's the only way it would work. And he'd just be there going, hey, Kevin Owens! Joe, if you're listening. Sorry, that sounded really ominous. Joe, if you're listening there, get closer to the microphone. Right, back to the questions. We have loads. So Facebook, we'll start from the bottom and work our way up.
Cool.
Much like Drake does. We've got Jai. I was going to say Jai because I know I'm going to butcher your whole name. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Zabuvka, I believe it's pronounced.
It's not how it's spelled. So I'm okay. Happy just go with Jai.
Yeah, that's quite common with Polish names.
I know. I think I may have said the shoot name of yours once, and I panicked when I was starting reading it. I was like, oh no. I'm just going to go first names. Anyway, what does a honey badger do?
Oh, of course he's asked me this. A honey badger famously doesn't give a flip. I won't use the full profanity. This came up in Jay Robbins' episode. And we were just, again, chatting silly bollocks. Duke Cannon, he'd done a twist on your classic question about cows and sheep. And he was basically saying who'd won in a fight between, I think it was a grizzly bear and a gorilla. And Jay Robbins decided to throw a honey badger into the mix. And to make his own sort of dream animal triple threat as opposed to Scotty's wrestling company triple threat. And I think Jay Robbins now taken that and he's now going to name... Did you see his match with ADM? I don't know if you had a chance to watch it. He did this sweet sort of springboard senton from the middle rope. And that's now getting called Honey Badger, Don't Give a Flip. In honour of that sort of random outburst he made on the SCW podcast.
Wrestling's weird, right?
I know, right?
We got Sean McCulloch. I can do McCulloch. I can do Scottish ones. Very easy. Outside of wrestling, one footballer to wrestle, one to tag with, and one to squash. Which I never thought I'd get to use wrestle bury or oh god, what was it called? What's the segment called? Wrestle bury. Anyway, it doesn't matter. It's like Shagmarried.
Shagmarried annoyed.
I'm getting confused here. Anyway, Sean, outside wrestling, one footballer to wrestle, one to tag with, and one to squash.
We'll tag with Henrik Larsson because he's my favorite footballer of all time. We'll squash Chris Boyd because he's just really annoying. And who would I have a match with? I'll put on a 5-star classic with Leo Messi. We'll do that. Nice and simple.
Work the leg.
Yeah.
It was tag. It's literally in there. It was wrestle tag. Wrestle tag buddy was the segment I had. Oh, yeah. Jesus, what idiot. Anyway, Tom has asked. This is Tom who's got himself out the fridge to ask a question. Very good of him. I didn't read this question before I started. How many midgets riding at you on bikes with bicycle helmets could you take on with a baseball bat before you got literally overrun?
Of course he's come in with like essentially a Nazi zombies question because he's obsessed with Call of Duty. Well, Tom, how far in between these midgets are we talking? Are we talking one after that?
Well, have you got enough time to swing back and
yeah, because I reckon if you just keep lining them up, I'll keep knocking them down. So probably until I get tired.
Even then, you could just poke it, jib it forward instead for a little bit. That'll...
Yeah, I mean, if they're midgets, I might not even need the bat. I'll just start big booting them and just taking them out because they're not going to be very high up. They'll be even lower down on a bike.
I think for podcast purposes, we probably should have went with little people or height deficient. I don't know, height deficiency is that probably more PG
or just people the same height as Tom.
I stood next to Tom. He's got definitely got a big personality. I didn't realize how short he was in comparison. Love you, Tom.
Yeah. So we'll go 69 banter.
Oh yeah, nice. Lads.
Ooh, lads.
We've got Hull PG asking, who is your favorite play-by-play commentary partner? Why is it JP? We didn't even speak about your commentary time. Well, we'll get to that at some point. Who's your favorite play-by-play commentary partner?
JP, why is JP? JP's the best, because as we say on Empire, two parties are better than one. In wrestling, outside of JP, I love Excalibur. I think he brings so much to AEW. But my favorite commentary team of all time was probably Michael Cole and Taz on like SmackDown, until Taz went off to join ECW, the New Breed Unleashed, back in the day. That was probably like my favorite ever duo on commentary. I was a big SmackDown kid around about that time. So Michael Cole and Taz was probably my favorite combination. But my favorite play-by-play right now is Excalibur. I've got a lot of love for Kevin Kelly as well. I've always liked Kevin Kelly.
Cool. It's also asked a stupid question, which is, would you rather wrestle 100 duck-sized horses or one horse-sized duck?
Oh, duck-sized horses.
Yeah.
Because the totally one horse-sized duck is terrifying, and it will just kill me instantly. Just pecks me once. Massive. Be a massive duck. So yeah, duck-sized horses. Let's
think
go.
Of the wingspan, at least.
Oh, man.
We'll just take it in. Right.
Take over the world.
Raising to our new duck leader. Andrew has asked, who would win in a fight, Yap Stam or Bobo Baldi?
Oh, Bobo Baldi. Bobo's going to get you. Easy.
I just like there's a football question. I actually heard of both the footballers.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. I'm very proud. I listened to the FCW podcast, and I'm kind of in the camp of, if you give me any football references after 2002, I probably will not know what you're talking about. Other than the obvious, Messi, Ronaldo, all that kind of jazz.
I made Duke proud by delving into a bit of Warhammer knowledge to bring up. I just thought, right, I've got this one thing that I know now. I need to find a place in conversation to drop it in. And I just shoehorned it into this, but I can't remember what we were talking about at the time. But it was this thing about, there was this planet in the Warhammer universe that apparently has a never-ending tidal wave either on it or surrounding it. So all the people on the planet have to never stay in the same place for too long because they'll just get swept up by this tidal wave. So that sounds awful. And apparently this was like a very deep cut of lore that I'd found. And it was I just went on to Warhammer Reddit and I just started scrolling until I saw something interesting.
Copy paste.
But I'm sure he appreciated it. He did. He seemed happy at the time.
But Bochco actually asked a wrestling question. My God. What has been the member of right, I'm gonna read this verbatim because it doesn't sound like it's gonna go well. Who has been the member of FCW roster that you would most like to take to test yourself?
Oh, okay.
Before it I does find... make sense. Sorry, yeah. I'm sorry, Bochco. I read that in my head and going, that doesn't make sense, but I've said it out loud now. It actually is a question. I apologize, Bochco.
You treat member, it's a second language, English, he's a Spanish lad, so Tijuana Dumbarton, as we all know. And he wasn't able to speak English until Duke Cannon wrote it on his character sheet. I don't know if you've seen that. That's how that actually happened. because wrestling.
Yeah.
I would have said before I'd found out that I was going to be wrestling him in this tournament, it would be in Sebastian Asher. Because I remember when I showed up to training on the first night, he was there. And it's that old adage about JBL used to say it about Randy Orton, or if you like built a wrestler / sports entertainer from the ground up, you'd get him. I think FCW wise, DAPW wise, it's Sebastian. Again, I don't agree with everything that he does and how he operates. I think it's very good probably for him in the long run that he's finally kicked Marcus Hunter to the curb. I don't think they were helping each other. I think he needs to go out on his own and prove that he's actually probably the most talented guy arguably in the company, in my opinion. I think he's got a bit of everything. He can fly. He can tap you out. He can put everything that he's got behind a massive spear and take it out. I just think Sebastian Asher is like seriously future heavyweight championship material. And I think hopefully now he can show it. I am getting the chance to wrestle him and Spike in a triple threat match in this tournament. I'm going to have my work cut out for me because as we know, Spike is one of the best junior heavyweights in the whole country, never mind just the FCW. But I'm going to go in there and give him the best shot. Again, Spike would have been another name on that list if I hadn't already scheduled to have a match with him. In terms of people who I haven't faced, I'm going to throw Samuel out there from Redgate. Again, I think he's one of the best things coming out of DAPW. And I think he's one that we've yet to see the best of. Once he gets more opportunities, I think he's going to prove to everyone how dangerous he is. And I'd love the chance to get in the ring with him myself. I would like to avoid the red mist, though. It doesn't look fun. Emily Hayden didn't have a good time. And neither did Valak during the Rumble. So I'll say Samuel. Samuel's the guy I would like to wrestle that I've not had the chance to wrestle yet.
Fantastic. So we've got Rich Money coming in with...
Oh, God.
Why do you constantly feel small and inferior to Rich Money, of which you are?
Wow. This is the guy that's been ducking me for like the best part of a year. I keep calling him out all the time. I keep saying, look, let's have a match. You've clearly got a problem with me. You think you're better than everyone. It seems to be me, though, that he's got more of a problem with than anyone else. I don't know why. I've tried to be civil with him on commentary and tried my best to get on with him. And I've ignored all the rubbish put downs that he's got for me. He insists on calling me Pat as well. He says like that, Pat. Like it's just out the corner of his mouth, Pat. My name's Patrick, or Paddy, if you get on with me. Don't call me Pat. It annoys me, especially the way he says it. It annoys me. And he knows it annoys me, and that's why he does it. But he's an absolute tosser. So I'm not going to rise to it, even though I have slightly. But again,
just he was like a Scrooge McDuck. He just sees the crowd, and he's just like, I want that. What about that?
He's jealous. That's what it is, Billy. That's what he is. He's nasty to me because he's jealous. That's what it is.
We've got Kieran Douglas. So the first question we've answered, because it's usually part of our core question set, which is what made you decide to start wrestling. We've got that. But the other one is, who would you trust to have your back in the ring?
Well, I think Kieran knows it's him. Kieran's become my guy. We've gotten very close over the last year since we met at training. He's had a bit of a nasty injury for the past few months, but he's been out. But he's been out with that. He's just coming back. I think he's coming back to training this week, though, as we speak. Kieran's somebody I really want to work with. I think we get on so well. I think that's going to translate, hopefully, in the ring one day. In terms of people that have had my back, Jay Robin's been one. Like I said, we've had a few tag team matches together. So that would be the two. It would be Kieran Douglas and Jay Robin. Those are the guys that have had my back so far during my journey, and I'm sure they will do in the future as well.
And the final question we've got through through Facebook is from Tom again. Tom's back with a great question for those fellow podcasters that enjoyed the OSW review.
Oh, he's done it.
I'm going to try and do it justice because I think someone else also asked this on Instagram, because I'm panicking now because I just remembered people have asked more questions. Do there?
You going to do the accent?
I'm going to try it. My throat's killing me, but I'm going to definitely give it a go. And it won't go well. I'm really conscious about it now. Oh, I was going to go all stereotype. What bar?
Yes! It's
Patryk Peterski.
Oh, I'm glad he's asked. Because this became a thing. It was either the last show that I was at, because I missed a fight before Christmas, sadly, because I was on holiday. But the last show I was at, it was just us sitting around, kind of once everything was set up, just going full OSW. What bar is this wrestler? What bar is that wrestler? What bar is Patryk Peterski? Patryk Peterski is probably a Milky Bar, I would say. Maybe what I do, spicy, spicy on the screen or whatever. For those of you somehow don't know what a Milky Bar is.
For those that know my show, we won't be doing a spicy, spicy, but so go Google it.
So don't even Google it. No, go to the shop and buy one because it's amazing. But yeah, the rapper. For those of you who don't know what bar is, I should probably explain that quickly. It's become like the running joke at train now that I've brought up. What bar is this rest? What bar is that rest? So OSW Review did this great segment on their show where if somebody's wearing usually a sort of outlandish attire, if it's like jazzy colors or whatever, they'll go, "What bar is Patryk Peterski, Billy Strachan?" Mm-hmm. And they'll just bring up, it started off with like chocolate bars, but it's like, it's branched out into basically anything. They've done like cigarette packets in the past. They've done like drinks, etc. Just what does this wrestle look like? Right now, I would say a Milky Bar, because I've been rocking the kind of like blue and white and with a wee bit of sort of red. This is like the sort of color on my on the bucket hat.
I don't want to throw a little bit of controversy here. Do you mean Milky Way?
Oh, I do. Christ, I know. Thank you for correcting me. No, Milky Way is Milky Bar is a totally different thing. Yeah, I am very much a Milky Way. No, you're right. Sorry, Billy. Thank you. I am a Milky. I mean, Milky Bars are good as well. But yeah, milk. That's bad. That's poor. That's very poor.
I want to make sure to correct you just in case we've got some controversy in the comments.
I know. Yeah, absolutely.
Did you mention blue? I was like, you've went wrong here.
See all those comments that you've typed in, right? Just delete them. Okay, exactly. Just go back on the backspace. This is why you wait to the end of the video to comment. This is why you wait to the end of the video to make your comments, because things might get corrected. But yeah, I am Milky Way, because I've got the mainly blue and white with a wee bit of red on it, and I taste great.
Just looking at crispy rolls, Milky Way crispy rolls. What a sweet that was.
Yep.
They paid that much for that many, though. Because they're now discontinued. Anyway, right.
Myself and JP did one, I think, for everyone at the last show we commented on together. So I think Tom Atlas was a can of Monster Energy, I think, which would have been for Ewan as well, Ewan Mackie, just green and black.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe I'll reveal that on a future episode of the SCW podcast. I'll go through the SCW roster and do what bar for them.
Just do it with Kevin, and he can start naming them and that.
Yeah.
Last question is from FCW's fearless leader, John Young.
Nice.
It is. What bar is Retro Randy Valentine?
I'm not going to need to do it on the podcast. I'll just get sent them in individually and I'll do them. Oh, I don't want to rip off OSW all the time, but is this now my thing? What bar is Retro Randy Valentine? Retro Randy Valentine is a flump.
I'm hoping he loves that.
Yeah, because I'm just thinking he's got all these kind of jazzy colours on. I'll do a flump bar. I'm pretty certain that I've got this nailed on. I'm gonna look up a flump bar here.
In the meantime, I'm gonna go for rainbow drops.
Okay, yeah. Retro Randy Valentine's a flump. He wears those sort of baby blues and sort of I'd say that. Randy's a flump. And flump's an old school thing as well for me. I was like a wee sort of corner shop sweetie. I will go for a flump. Retro Randy Valentine's a flump.
There's the quote for the episode. Retro Randy Valentine's
a flump. That's the name of the episode now. Retro Randy Valentine's a flump.
So what I should do for next season is just, you know how you do the Always Sunny bits at the start? I should just take a quote from the episode, put that at the start, and then just go into it. And that'll be it. Retro Randy Valentine's a flump. And then into the episode we go.
No context needed.
You'll find it. Listen to the whole 2-hour episode. You'll find the context somewhere.
That's your reward. That's your reward for listening to the whole thing.
Exactly. Before we wrap up then, we'll talk about the commentary gig that you've got. Again, was it just someone find out that you did a podcast, so you know how to actually speak into a microphone without sounding like an adult?
I think so. That might have played a part. Probably doing the FCW podcast helped as well. John just texted one day and said, look, there's an opportunity here for somebody to hop on Empire and do some commentary, because John wears a lot of hats within the company. One of them has been doing commentary in the past. So I think he maybe saw it as, well, Patryk can go and do this, and it's one less plate for me to spin on the day.
Mm-hmm.
And that guy was very, very happy to be asked to do it. And I've been doing it for, when was my first show? I think it was maybe June time, June, July, around about then. So I've been doing it ever since then. I've loved it, because I've been able to like take bits from like commentators, like I mentioned earlier, like Taz or Excalibur or Kevin Kelly, stuff that I've loved in the past, and just been able to like drop bits in and obviously develop my own style as well. And like you said, I've done stuff like this before, so I can talk for a long period of time fine. And I get the best, I'm out getting the best seat in the house to watch the shows. So it's a win-win for me. Loving it.
It's a job people don't realize it's not easy, because I was watching a show on YouTube and I was listening to the commentary and I hated it. I had to turn it down eventually because just it wasn't for me, and it just wasn't tickling my pickle, so to speak. So I thought, right, I'm gonna give this a go. How hard could it be? So I took a match. Thankfully, one of the guys at FCW, they sent me a match to watch that hasn't been online. Watched it, did my commentary in one take because I'm a fucking pro. So I did commentary in one take. Listened back to it. Oh, that was a lot harder than you make out. The pros make it look, especially if you're doing it live on the time as well. And and get make sure you get the stories in and getting all the.
Well, that's it. It's not just going superplex, cover, kick out, you know, TKO, whatever the move is. You like, especially for maybe guys that are like clicking on Empire for the first time, and they're maybe like, why is this man wrestling in a wedding dress and a skull mask? Don't know. that was my first exposure to FCW. So when you get a bit of context, like, oh, you see, Ian Ambrose is a bit of a guy, a bit of a character. And you're like, okay, cool. He's this eccentric boy. This makes sense now. Or why wrestler A, what fighting wrestler B? For example, the show that we just missed, none of the regular commentators were available. So I was on holiday. JP wasn't available. The commissioner was on holiday as well, actually wasn't able to do that show. And John was, again, doing even more than he would normally have to do, plus commentary. So we're going to be editing that in post. So I'm going to do that in post. And, for example, the first match we had that night was Bruiser Brad Evans making his FCW debut against Nathan North. So it's more. There's a lot more to that match than Bruiser Brad Evans versus Nathan North. You've got the whole context of Brad coming in last month and costing Game On the tag titles. Why do you do that? Well, it's because he's a member of the Foundation, and you can go into the history there. There's also the history between Brad and Nathan. Nathan and Brad were best mates back in the day. And so now, so on top of all that, you've got not only has Brad come in to cost those guys the titles and to give his friends the titles, he's turned on his former best friend. So there's layers and layers and layers that you've got to put across, as well as calling, you know, big boot, cover, kick out, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. You know, so yeah, there is a lot to go on. But the more you, it's like anything, the more you do it, then the more used to it you get, and the more you hopefully get better at it. Hopefully it's watchable.
I think my biggest issue is I'm not very good at the whole poker face. So if I'm watching a match that I personally don't enjoy, it takes a lot for me to actually make it sound enjoyable without me just going, this is a bit shit, lads.
I'm not into this at all.
Well, want to go take a break? We'll come back in about 10 minutes. I'm sure it'll be good by then.
I'm sure this headlock will be over by then.
It's like, oh, no, this isn't going well, guys. Do you want to just stop?
Call it a draw.
I'll try again. Cut. God, never put me in charge of anything wrestling wise. Let's leave me here and do the podcast instead. Right. So before we go, there's two questions we haven't asked. I'm sure you're on the edge of your seat because I forgot to put them into the question set. But I have noted on the top of my page here because if I don't, I forget. And yeah, I almost did. Patryk Peterski. I don't know why I tried to go for Irish towards the end there. What would win the fight? Two sheep or one cow?
I think it's got to be the cow. I'm in team cow. Because I think if the cow really wants to, then I think it could just go mental and take out the sheep. Yes, I know the theories behind, you know, the sheep, they have the numbers advantage. But I think the size of the cow is too much to overcome. If you piss off that cow enough, he's eventually going to say, nah, I've had enough of this.
What I hear is if the cow gets really pissed off, it gets back onto its hind legs and it starts shooting milk from its udders.
Exactly.
That's the...
Nobody wants that. Nobody wants that. Instant tap it.
And the last question that we've got here is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
So there's a funny story behind this line. I think maybe mentioned it in Jay Robbins' episode as well, accidentally. That used to be my go-to chat up line back in the day. And didn't have much success with it. And my friends used to slag me off with it. One of my friends in particular slagged me off that he was the manager of my Sunday League football team at the time. Oh, that's a terrible line, Patrick. Why are you using that? And he used it on a girl one time for a joke. And I attended their wedding about a year ago. So it worked. My favorite dinosaur is a velociraptor.
That's a nice classic.
Yeah, Jurassic Park. That was, I'm the right age for that. They were the coolest things in it. So yeah,
I'm trying to get my boy into dinosaurs. He's not taking them on yet. He likes felt instead. So anything with felt on it is the best thing ever. which, you know, as a 16-month-old, I think he's allowed that. So that's it. I think we haven't hit the hefty 2-hour mark.
Next time, don't worry.
Yeah, but I'll be perfectly honest, because I'm still on the seventh day of this never-ending cold, my throat is starting to die again. So I'm gonna go and rest it, get some honey down there, and whatever else fluids I can think of that go down there. That let's stop. I'm gonna stop that sentence, because it's not gonna end well for me. We're just gonna go forward. So from now, people can buy their tickets for DAPW.
Yes, there you go. See, you are coming around to it. Really, you are. Come on, it rolls off the tongue. Much better than DAPW, which is just awkward to say, or Dundee Academy Professional Wrestling, which is too long. Just that dub.
Anyway, we've got... So yeah, we've got that dub coming up. Tickets will be available going to is it Eventbrite still?
It used to be Eventbrite, so the easiest place to go now is just go on to faircitywrestling.com, and there's a link to the tickets there. And you can also check out the blogs that Sarah does on the website. She kind of reviews all the shows on there. And we've got like our Hall of Champions. So it's got, you can check out some profiles of the wrestlers and stuff. And there's links to Empire. Also, Fair City Wrestling on YouTube as well. You can check out Empire. And obviously, I think it's basically the same on all the socials. So yeah. And I'm just Patryk Peterski on Facebook. I'll plug my socials quickly as well. I'm just on Facebook though.
I was going to say, my next note was socials. So I think you've read my notes here.
I mean, I'm a fan. I've watched your show a lot, so I know the format.
I know, and you've met me in person, and I've revealed myself as really awkward.
You're not. You always say this. You're not as nearly as awkward as you seem to think you are.
Just leave me in a corner. I'll be quite happy. I'll make myself useful out of the way. But yeah. So it's. I've ended up just being awkward to finish off. You know, see, ending the podcast.
That's what happens. This is why me and Duke go on a ramble, and that just kind of adds into the outro. Out. Yeah.
Just because I don't want the conversation to ever end yet, but I don't have anything else to speak about. So we've got loads of wrestling coming up. Go to FCW website and find out more. This has been a great enlightening chat. Like I said, I always worry, I said this last few episodes, when I get someone who's kind of new, that we won't have a lot to speak about, especially if we don't get along or don't have any sort of rapport.
Aye.
Not a word.
Rapport is a word. Yes, that's the one. Yeah.
My brain's gone to mush already. It'll only be 90 minutes, like a football match. Yeah. Get the perfect balance, I suppose, with the banter and the wrestling.
There you go.
Right, anyway, let's go. So, yeah, thank you very much for joining me. It's been a pleasure. Hopefully I'll get to see you in 2024 if I can get back down to Dundee or wherever to go see some Fair City Wrestling. But no, yeah, it's been great. Thanks.
No problem. Until next time, Billy.